Hi, this is Randall Schwartz, host of Floss Weekly. This week, Guillermo Amaral joins me. We're going to be talking about telephony. We're going to be talking about FreeSWITCH. It's a great thing for getting people connected together. You're not going to want to miss this, so stay tuned.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Floss Weekly is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is Floss Weekly with Randall Schwartz and Guillermo Amaral. Episode 343, recorded July 1st, 2015. FreeSWITCH. This episode of Floss Weekly is brought to you by Braintree. If you're working on a mobile app and searching for the right payments API, check out the Braintree V.0 SDK. With one simple integration, you get every way to pay. To learn more and to try out the sandbox, go to braintreepayments.com/floss. And by DigitalOcean, simple and fast cloud hosting built for developers. Deploy an SSD cloud server in 55 seconds. Try it today for free. Visit DigitalOcean.com, and once you sign up, be sure to enter the promo code FLOSS in the billing section for a $10 credit. It's time for Floss Weekly, the show about free, Libre, open-source software. I am your host, Randall Schwartz, Merlin at Stonehenge.com, bringing you each week the movers, the shakers, the big projects, the little projects, projects you may be using every day and not aware of it, projects you might want to download right after the show and start playing with. I know that's happened numerous times to me. Joining me today is my co-host, Guillermo Amaral. Welcome back to the show.
Hey, man. Thank you.
And where are you speaking to us from?
About a mile away from you, actually.
yeah, it's surprisingly enough, we're both in Tijuana, which explains my sort of blockiness on the video. Hopefully, isn't going to interrupt the audio too much. But I happen to be down here for the week. It's a holiday week in the U.S., which is why I'm in Mexico. Go figure. Anyway, so I'm also in Tijuana. The two of us are both speaking to each other. This is the All South of the Border show, or at least for the host anyway. We'll have to find out where our guests are speaking to us from when we bring them on. But that will be in just a moment. Actually, let's talk about what we're going to be talking about today. We're going to be bringing on Anthony Minessale and Mike Jerris, who are going to be talking to us about FreeSWITCH. FreeSWITCH is telephony. It's about using software to direct calls and videos and all sorts of things back and forth. We've had a number of telephony shows on. We've had, I think just recently, recently being like 2 years ago, 2600 Hertz. We've had the Asterisk back in the early days of Asterisk, and I think a couple other ones, a couple others come to mind. But sorry, I didn't do my research this morning. It's still a little bit quiet, a little bit sleepy today. So what do you know about FreeSWITCH so far?
Well, not much. You know, I actually stopped playing with soft SIPs, I think they're called, or I don't really remember. But I remember voice over IP, basically. Yeah. Last thing I played around with was with Asterisk maybe 8 years ago or something. But I kind of get the idea. So you use the internet to talk to people.
Yeah, imagine that, communication over the internet, just like we're doing now, but with open source software.
Legacy devices, I suppose.
Yes. Well, that's very cool. Well, instead of us chatting about what we're going to be chatting about, we'll bring them on in just a second and get the truth right from the proverbial horse's mouth. But before we do that, we have a very important message, because this episode is being brought to you by Braintree, code for easy online payments. If you're building a mobile app and searching for simple payment solution, check out Braintree. The Braintree V.0 SDK makes it easy to offer multiple mobile payment types. Start accepting PayPal, Apple Pay, Bitcoin, Venmo, cards, and more, all with a single integration. They're simple and secure payments, code you can integrate in minutes. If you don't have time, you can give them a call, and they'll be able to handle the integration for you and walk you through it. Their SDK is in 7 languages, .NET, Node.js, Java, Perl, yay Perl, PHP, Python, Ruby. Elegant code with clear documentation and 10 lines of in-app code. Braintree offers you an easy way to accept multiple payment types with one integration. Quick, knowledgeable developer support if you have any questions. Start accepting Apple Pay, PayPal, Bitcoin, Venmo, cards, and whatever's next, all with a single integration. With the Braintree V.0 SDK, one small snippet of code and you're set up in less than 10 minutes. To learn more, and for your first $50,000 in transactions free, go to braintreepayments.com/floss. And we appreciate Braintree for supporting Floss Weekly and other shows in this TWiT network. So let's go ahead and bring on our guest. Let me bring Anthony on first. Anthony, welcome to the show.
Hi. Great to be here.
Great. And where are you speaking to us from?
I'm in Brookfield, Wisconsin, and which is the Midwest.
The Midwest, the part of the states that I've flown over many times but never actually landed, I don't think. Not enough high tech for me there, so I guess it's probably why I haven't been there. And also spring on Mike Jerris. Mike, welcome to the show.
Hey, thank you.
And where are you speaking to us from?
I'm calling from Ann Arbor, Michigan.
Oh, so you're both sort of in the Midwest there. Great. Well, let me face that general direction and wave. Okay, so I'm waving at you. I don't know if you can see that from here, but okay, I'm waving that direction. Anyway, so this show is not This Week in Geography. This show is about open source software. So, Anthony, why don't you start? What is FreeSWITCH, and how did it get started, and what problem is it solving?
Well, FreeSWITCH is an open source soft switch, and that's basically software that performs switching of telephony protocols. So if you imagine a network switch is used for connecting a bunch of NIC cables together and connecting a network, FreeSWITCH is the same kind of idea, only with voice and chat and media protocols. So it's a software you can run on a commodity hardware, basically, that opens the different internet connections for various stuff like SIP or traditional telephone hardware, which is kind of a thing of the past these days since all the big carriers are using voice over IP now. But there's still some people that only trust their own equipment, so we support direct hardware interface, as well as recently we've started working a lot with WebRTC, which allows browsers to connect. That way we can turn any browser into basically a two-way media client using audio and video. And then we can mix that together, maybe put it in a conference with somebody who's calling in from a cell phone over the regular PSTN, or we can turn it into SIP and call someone on a desk phone over voice over IP. So in a nutshell, FreeSWITCH is basically a telecommunication platform for building apps and combining technologies.
Well, now, I understand you were working on Asterisk before starting FreeSWITCH. What made you stop working on Asterisk and start working on FreeSWITCH?
Well, that was the good old days of early 2000s. Actually, a lot of the people on our team originally started out working on Asterisk, and basically, anyone who's not familiar with Asterisk, it's an open source PBX. We all got acclimated with it for various reasons. I personally was using it because I had a business where we were doing a call center. We were doing outsourced tech support around that time, and we needed some kind of call center solution, and we discovered Asterisk because we were using it as our internal PBX. As we started using it, we kind of pushed the boundaries of its capabilities and ended up becoming very intimate with the software to the point where we were actually doing maintenance on it. I ended up having commit access to Asterisk at one point and did a lot of work on it. But as I worked on it, I started to see kind of a void that could be filled. It had kind of centered around the idea of a certain paradigm, and we started to kind of have weekly meetings where we would chat about different stuff, and we kind of got inspired for an idea to kind of to rebuild kind of a fresh new kind of core for doing more versatile interfaces. And understandably, the Asterisk project was very busy and had a lot of customers and is built on a business model of keeping those customers happy. So a lot of the ideas that we had were a little too avant-garde for their taste at the time because, you know, starting over and rewriting software is not easy. So basically, we were so inspired that we started working on it, and within less than a year, we had our own working software. So we now, with that separate software, we had less limitations on trying to keep business happy since we were fresh, of course, which means we're all alone. But we spent many years coding and building a core and building modules and expanding the software and built our own user base. And now we basically have a cross-platform was one of the things we wanted to be able to do, because Asterisk was limited to Linux at the time, and we kind of thought that we should be able to make our software run in all environments. And also, there's some fundamental architecture stuff that I really wanted to change in Asterisk that would have been way too invasive, so I had the luxury of being able to start over. So that's basically the key reasons.
Okay, very cool. And Mike, what's your involvement with the project?
I've been around in the project since day one. The very initial things that I did was I did the Windows porting kind of before we released, got that all working. Since then, you know, involved on a day-to-day basis. I do most of the code review on contributions from the community, and I do a lot of bug fix stuff and some features as well. I'm also pretty involved in packaging and build system for FreeSWITCH.
So I'm sure you get this question all the time, but why might I reach for Asterisk versus FreeSWITCH, or are they not? Is it like apples and oranges at this point?
I mean, I think it depends on what you're trying to do. Best tool out there. FreeSWITCH tends to be more of a toolbox of all kinds of different things you can do. And it tends to be very flexible as far as pulling different things together. So forever we've supported, you know, all the way up to ultra wideband, 48K audio codecs. Our video support is probably the best out there of a switch like we have. What else do we have? We support stereo audio, which I don't know if anything else out there does. The way you can actually interface, if you want to extend the functionality, is much easier. So it drives us to cool abilities, like very easily being able to integrate a face detection algorithm that tracks your face on a video and can manipulate the video as a result. So just the general flexibility and just the vast range of features is probably our major strong points, as well as the cross-platform, like Tony was saying.
So Mike, for cross-platform, you mentioned you also work on the build system. What are you guys using for that?
So the build system's a lot of different pieces. For all of the Linux, Unix-type operating systems, it's an AutoTools-based build system, and for Windows, it's Microsoft Visual Studio-based build system. On our cross-platform, we tend to target Debian and Jesse as our primary platform, but we have a pretty vast community of people actively supporting, for example, CentOS and Windows.
And what type of corporations are using your product right now? Do you know of any big corporations, or is it, you know, non-profit corporations, or is it just, you know, individual people using your software?
So let me just think of who I can talk about publicly. So one company that has publicly posted all about their use of FreeSWITCH is UMA, which is a telecommunications provider that sell a device that I know you can get at Best Buy. They use FreeSWITCH both in their little device and on their back end. Then as far as the range, it goes all the way from small guy just with a home or small business PBX, up to education, K-12 schools, large federal, we're working with some federal government projects, and all the way up to very large corporations, none of which I think I can disclose.
No problem. Worry about it. But okay, so you also mentioned cross-platform. Does that also involve, you know, not just Windows, Mac, Linux, and maybe FreeBSD or BSD? But does that also involve, like, let's say on x86, on ARM? Can somebody run this on their Raspberry Pi, for example?
Yeah, we do. We don't have packages currently, but we do actively work with it on Raspberry Pi, and we have some Pis that we've done work on. They're a little CPU constrained, but you can do some basic functionality on the Raspberry Pi.
Oh, not bad. And do you know if anybody's using this for podcasting? I remember I used to use Astros for some of the earlier podcasts, you know, a voice-only podcast before. I don't know if you heard of any podcasts using your software right now.
I've heard of some. We actually do a weekly podcast called the ClueCon Weekly every Wednesday, and we use our conferencing system and direct YouTube streaming, all built on our own stuff on FreeSWITCH to produce that.
ClueCon, is that some sort of a LARP team, or what is ClueCon?
Nice. So ClueCon is a voice over IP developers conference that we have in Chicago every August. And basically, people interested in voice over IP and people developing solutions for that and kind of our higher end users all get together for a week in Chicago. And it's a mix of very technical talks. We try to avoid the typical conference marketing talks, and people really dig into different solutions that you can do with FreeSWITCH and other open source voice over IP and communications products. We try to come up with new ideas and push the limits.
Nice. So let's talk about features here. When I used to use Asterisk, for example, just to name one, I'm not saying you guys should be compared to an Asterisk all the time. Let's say, do you guys support video? Is it only audio? What kind of features can you sell me on here?
We try not to sell people because, you know, it's absolutely, it's your free choice to use it. But audio, features mono and stereo audio from narrowband 8K audio all the way up to 48K. Video, we support VP8, H.264, and H.264 video and, file formats for playback and record. The whole range that's available out there are all in there. We also have some chat interface kind of features that work with both kind of your SIP chat, and there's also some SMS functionality as well.
Okay, so you mentioned WebRTC. I'm sure most people might not know what it is or how it works. I know we've used it before here on, I think we've had projects here on the show that have used it before. But could you give us a little idea of what it is and how you guys are implementing interface on it?
Sure. WebRTC is a plugin-less technology that's currently implemented, I believe, in Chrome and Firefox and maybe Opera. It allows for real-time audio and video functionality are the primary purposes. So right in your browser, you can essentially do everything you can do with Skype right inside your browser without having to install extra software. So it's a big enabler for, let's say, a website that wants to add, you know, like us having this conversation here directly to their website. You can just press a button on the page and, you know, immediately be connected via FreeSWITCH to either an audio-only connection we could bridge to a traditional phone system, or with an agent on a similar browser, or on a real video, like a SIP video phone. You could immediately connect with someone. Let's say it was a company that provided technical support on how to build your IKEA furniture. So you could go directly in a video call and show them things, and they could show you, you know, no, this is the right piece or something like that.
So are you guys constrained on how many people you can add to a channel or to a conference call? Could somebody replace Google Hangouts with this?
I think we actually scale a little bit better than Google Hangouts. What I've found on Google Hangouts, like on my laptop, is once you get up around, I don't know, 8 to 10 participants, the laptop starts really heating up and cooking and, you know, running the fans full bore. The approach we take instead of their approach is called SFU, where it sends a copy of all the videos to you and you have to decode everyone. The approach we take is we send all the copies of the video to the the server, and we kind of display them on a grid, kind of Brady Bunch style, and we then encode a single encoder for each for each codec. So we kind of optimize the encoding and send that one encoding back to everyone. It's much easier on the clients and gives us the ability to do all kinds of interesting functions where we can manipulate the video, we can lay graphics over them, we can rearrange the layouts and all of that on the fly, and you know, send that to everybody.
Okay, so, well, as you know, open source tends to be about community, so maybe you can tell us how big is your community now for this project? How many people are working on it?
As far as contributors, a while back we looked at like kind of the number of contributors over the last year, and it had been about 40 or 50. We recently put a GitHub-like system called Stash in, which allows us to get pull requests, and the number of contributions is exploding. I think I got 20 pull requests yesterday alone. That was not a common occurrence, but I mean we're getting, you know, a number of pull requests every day. So. As far as users, I mean, we don't really track the number of users or installations or have any sort of, you know, feedback technology. So we've got some ideas, but I can't really say how many people are using it.
So you guys aren't implementing an NSA backend right now, or is that, you know, in the near future?
Not currently. That's for the near future, of course.
Okay, well, you did mention you don't track users. Is that something you guys thought about originally? You know, not keeping maybe a phone home feature on that, or it's maybe just never really happened?
I mean, we've discussed the possibility of it, and I just don't think there's any real advantages of it other than visibility of the numbers, and I think that people get uncomfortable with those sorts of features, so. Wasn't really something we were interested in doing.
Okay. Well, yeah, as your community or your project grows, I'm sure you're going to get somebody there who's going to say, I want metrics. I want to know who's using our product and how. Well, yeah, I personally like the idea of an open PBX and, well, let's say an open PBX in an office environment. Do you know how expensive it would be to actually implement this? And let's say if I have a small business, would I just need a standard computer I have laying around, or is there any specific hardware I could buy?
If you're doing VoIP only, just any kind of modern server hardware would be totally fine. So that physical cost is minimal. If you're doing soft phones, those costs are pretty minimal. The real cost would be hard phones if you want a physical desk phone.
Do you need just a standalone computer for that, or can, let's say, I be using the PBX system on my secretary's computer while she's, I don't know, using Facebook or something?
No, I mean, I would do dedicated hardware. For your phone system, audio tends to be pretty timing sensitive, so the Facebook CPU spikes may affect your audio a little bit.
What about competition? Are you guys seeing any other similar projects like this sprouting out?
I don't think we really consider the other open source projects competition. We work pretty closely with the other open source projects out there. I think we are targeting, you know, matching a feature set of more of the commercial guys. So our recent work on video MCU much closer targets the big video conferencing MCU manufacturers than anything else out there in open source.
Okay. Go ahead. Okay, so how compatible are you guys with, you know, hardware that's already available? I remember there used to be like PCI cards that had RJ47 or 45, I think it is, for the phone line that, you know, you could use to as a bridge to the legacy system. Do you guys support any of that?
Yeah, I mean, we have support for analog lines through a number of different manufacturers' cards, and also support for ISDN PRI lines. It works fine. It works great. People use it. To be honest, it's worked for a long time, and we don't usually make many changes to that code. It is all kind of legacy, and people are moving away from it.
And whether you're an experienced code warrior or just getting started, you need flexible, reliable, and affordable hosting. DigitalOcean provides developers with Droplets, which are virtual private servers that can be customized and deployed quickly to host websites, web apps, production applications, personal projects, virtual desktops, and almost anything else you can think of with full root access. I myself am a DigitalOcean customer, found out about them back at Scale back in February, and I run a little $5 a month box to build all my packages for my FreeBSD box. Because DigitalOcean is built for developers and used by over 400,000 of them, including me. You can choose your own OS, Ubuntu, CentOS, Debian, Fedora, CoreOS, and FreeBSD. That's mine. A one-click install allows you to quickly deploy apps like Django, Docker, Drupal, LAMP, GitLab, MediaWiki, Node.js, WordPress, Ghost, Magento, OwnCloud, Ruby on Rails, and more. And we've had most of those people on Floss Weekly, actually. It's highly scalable to meet the demands of a rapidly growing application or business. The servers can have up to 20 CPUs, 64 gigs of RAM, and 640 gigs of SSD hard drive space. Very, very fast stuff. You can get easy to deploy servers in regions all over the world with gigabit speeds and 99.99% uptime. And it's so easy to get started, you can deploy an SSD cloud server in as little as 55 seconds. DigitalOcean has incredibly affordable and straightforward pricing. Servers started at only $5 per month. There's also hourly pricing available, starting at less than a penny per hour. But we're going to make it so you get started today and deploy an SSD cloud server for free. Visit DigitalOcean.com and create an account. Once you confirm your email and account information, go to the billing section and enter the promo code FLOSS for a free $10 credit. That's plenty to get started and explore what DigitalOcean can do. That's DigitalOcean.com. And once you sign up, enter the code FLOSS in the billing section for a $10 credit. And we thank DigitalOcean for helping sponsor this show. But actually, Guillermo, did you see a couple questions in the chat room you might want to ask?
Well, yeah, sure. Let's see. Web 9554 asks, do hardware phones work with the system?
Hardware phones?
It could be a lot of things. I'm not sure what he's asking.
Yeah, but you mean like phones?
I guess
like
he means legacy, right? Maybe? Yeah. So yeah, I guess we already answered that part. I guess you would be able to maybe use some legacy phone with this, right?
Yes. Well, FreeSWITCH's SIP interface pretty much works with any kind of SIP endpoint, all the way from a carrier interface. One of the things you can do with FreeSWITCH is scale it. Either you can make a very small FreeSWITCH server that has a few phones registered to it, and we do support a bunch of kind of phone-centric SIP features, such as putting calls on hold and shared line appearance emulation and a bunch of stuff like that. But at the same time, the SIP interface can also talk to a carrier where you might be aggregating traffic from five other machines connected with SIP proxies in a bunch of complicated environment where you're, say, building your own telco and feeding SIP down to smaller interfaces. So you might have a very big company with a very large interface like Level 3 who's giving SIP traffic to someone who's got, say, five FreeSWITCH servers, and then they're using that for media gateways over to an even smaller provider, and that provider is going to some guy's business, and that guy's business could have a bunch of phones connected to that instance, and every one of them in that scenario could be using FreeSWITCH all configured separate ways. So that's one of the goals we had for versatility, was to make sure that we could use the software as several different roles in the same setup with different sets of configuration to remain versatile enough to be able to handle all those different situations.
And what about virtualization? I can't pronounce it right now. I need more coffee.
Virtualization,
yeah. Yeah, there you go. Thank you. Could you run this on a virtual machine somewhere?
Yes, you can. We don't recommend it for people who are in production to run virtual machines unless they have an extensive background with understanding how virtualization works, because FreeSWITCH being a real-time application requires certain things. If you're leveraging it for lots of media timing, for audio, for instance, you need to know how to configure your virtual instance to have access to the correct hardware for the timing source. To make sure that, because virtualization is a great invention and allows us to run several different machines inside of one physical machine, and a lot of software really doesn't have any time limits on stuff. You know, like if you're just playing around in a typical application like Microsoft Word and a Windows virtual machine, there's no rush. You know, you're never going to know how long it took from the minute you click something till it responded. You know, it's kind of irrelevant. But with voice over IP, you have a deadline for the audio. It's basically sending several packets per second, multitudes, like at least 50 or more. Each one of them is expected to arrive in that slice of time. And if the timing is kind of lax, which is an intentional thing to allow more virtual machines to run concurrently, then you'll have kind of distortions in your audio and stuff. But if you set the virtual machine to actually access the real timing hardware on the machine, you can get better results. And also, if you're running a jail type virtualization where it's a container based implementation, so rather than running an entirely different virtual machine, you might have one Linux kernel, for instance, with a whole bunch of Linux instances, that tends to work better. The trade-off with that is we're kind of at a crossroads with those things, because we've had OpenVZ around for a really long time, and that one runs on an older kernel. So FreeSWITCH takes advantage of some of the newer features of the newer kernels. So there's some newer stuff like Linux containers and Docker and all those fancy things, and those are using some of the newer kernels. And there's news that OpenVZ is starting to use a newer kernel too, and there's kind of like a big mashup of like kind of like the cell phone wars, only with virtualization and kernels and all that stuff. So hopefully that stuff will settle, and we'll probably have some kind of hybrid of all these different technologies that will make it even easier to do. But we do, yes, have people doing it. We have, they use Amazon virtual stuff, or they'll use all OpenVZ or the KVM. There's a whole bunch of them. So on a small thing, for sure it'll work. If you're doing a high deployment, you have to have a kind of a working knowledge of how to do it. And we tend not to support it because, you know, support it as in helping people. So we do support it as in it will work. But as far as helping people, we give minimal amounts. We will tell you the same kind of advice I'm saying here. And that's as far as it can go, because we really can't. We don't have enough time to teach everyone how it works. So that's basically the story on virtualization.
Well, that's good. I can see somebody who maybe knows how to configure this correctly. You could probably get this working without that many delays, which is good. We did get another question from the web, from Web 9554, actually. Do you support CRTP with SIP calls?
ZRTP? Yes, we do. In fact, we were one of the early adopters of it. We actually have a close relationship with Phil Zimmerman. He's attended our KluCon conference the last maybe 5 years in a row. He tends to come to our security roundtable that we have on the middle of the conference. It's like a two-hour presentation on security and stuff. And we were working with his library when it was still in a beta state, and we now have it in there. In fact, they've now made a new version of the library for it that we're probably considering migrating to. We still have the original one that he was using while I was developing the stuff. And that's like an onboard thing. We just support it if you enable it. You can choose to turn it off at runtime, or you can leave it on, and it will just detect and automatically work with it.
So let's talk security for a second. What kind of security are you guys implementing with SSL, or does it even come to play with something like this?
With security for FreeSWITCH in general, or
yeah, in general.
Different security aspects. We have we support SRTP both with SDS key exchange, ZRTP, and DTLS. We also support SIP over TLS. And then for WebRTC, we support WebSockets over SSL as well. We actually have SIP over WebSockets as well. There are some WebRTC-based SIP stacks. SIP actually translates itself all right to WebSockets. So basically, two or three different groups have written SIP stacks in JavaScript that run in your browser. So essentially, you can build an HTML5 app that will use the WebSockets on the browser to make a SIP connection. And several different voice over IP software support it now, including us. So you can register with SIP to straight to FreeSWITCH, and it'll pretty much operate like any other SIP endpoint. We also invented our own protocol called Virto, which is using also WebSockets, but with a different signaling transport. And those things all can work over SSL.
Okay, so let's say we have another question here from the chat, I think. Do you guys support Docker?
We support Docker. Kind of ties into the earlier virtualization stuff. We do. I've heard tale of a few people that are using it. We haven't explored Docker very much at the moment. We have heard about it, and it's got some intriguing aspects. I know that it will function. Maybe if we used it more, we might find some ways to enhance it to work better there. I think it's a little bit challenging because we have so many different ports that we use for voice over IP. You know, every different call uses different UDP ports. And I remember hearing about a little bit of a challenge to configure it properly because of those things. But other than that, it does function properly that way. It might be a more popular solution in the near future because as we've moved forward, our new release is coming. We're in the beta stage right now. And as we brought in more video features and more kind of newer elements, see, being an open source project, we revolve around a bunch of dependencies. So we work together with those different dependency libraries to produce the working software. So some of them are newer versions than a lot of distros have, and we've been kind of trying to find the perfect balance of running a version of libraries that are available to everyone so that all platforms can run it. But there are some challenges with the newer video stuff because it's kind of maybe a revolution, you might want to call it, going on with like free video and audio media stuff at a higher level. And so a lot of the libraries that implement, say, the video codecs and the audio codecs in the video file formats and all these different components that make real-time video possible, including communicating over the web with WebRTC, they're all very fresh, as in like the changes to make it work properly are just being worked on in the last 6 to 12 months. And we're running pretty much the newest version of the library that we can that's available in a release somewhere, which is why we tend to favor Debbie and Jesse, which was just released and has a refresh of all those libraries. So those challenges of having such newer versions cause a lot of conflicts on systems, and I understand that one of the problems that Docker tries to solve is those environments being kind of hard to manage. So you might see more people trying it out so that they can run our packages and stuff from Debbie and Jesse like inside of some other environment without having to change, because not everybody wants to modify their environment when they're used to it and whatnot. But we've kind of, it's incredible amount of work to get packaging. And in order to have more people be able to use the software without having an in-depth knowledge of how to compile and build a list of like 100 dependencies, we've worked really hard to make some binary packages. But that work being so hard, we can only do one at a time. And that's why we've been focusing on Debian for the time being, because that one actually has the stuff we need and it updates fast enough to keep up with us. We're pretty much in sync with the bleeding edges of the Chrome browser and the Debian. We're already working on getting some stuff that'll go into the next version of Debian. So it's kind of a tedious process, but that's pretty much how we do it. And I think Docker will probably make it easier for some people who don't want to switch, you know, their entire environment around.
Okay, and are you both working full-time on this? How does your project make money?
Well, the project itself doesn't make money being an open source project. But we do have a consulting firm, which is called FreeSWITCH Solutions, which is run by the core team. So basically what we do is we have a base layer of support that we provide being an open source project. We have lots of people using our software, and then they file requests for features or they file bugs. And we work on them to the best of our ability. We also have businesses that are using our software for monetary gain, and they have more of a pressing need to get certain things fixed in a certain amount of time, or they have needs that are unique to them. So as a kind of a base service, we provide as needed fixes for really critical issues and stuff, and some people who need to have a higher level of attention, so we sell support contracts as well as one-time bounties for adding features that might be particular to someone, or we do custom development for pretty much anything that someone might want to do. They want to get their environment up and running faster. So that consulting firm kind of takes some of the people's needs and puts them it's kind of like an insurance model. Like you're buying insurance for your software to make sure that if you have problems, that they have someone to take care of it slightly faster than when we get around to it, which is the default for our open source community. So we kind of layer those on top of each other. And it works really well because basically people who are using FreeSWITCH to just play around, you know, they have valuable input too, and we look at their issues and bugs and we work on them. But businesses, like, they depend on our software, so they need a little more attention than others might. So it's kind of like a hybrid relationship.
Well, then I'm a bit curious then. So how separated is FreeSWITCH, the project, from FreeSWITCH Solutions, the organization? I mean, who decides the roadmap? Does the FreeSWITCH Solutions decide the entire roadmap then?
No. It's kind of like the old days vaudeville skit where the people have lots of hats. And the same guy works in the office and he's like the hotel guy, and then he switches his hat and he's the bellman. We have the roadmap is driven by the needs of the overall balance of the community, including the customers and the open source users. And basically we have developed a crystal ball of our own that we can tell. That's why we have our KluCon conference every year. We bring everybody together. We get a few hundred people in a room who all really love voice over IP and media, and we give a bunch of presentations and we read the room and we get an idea of what we should work on next based on all those combinations. And it's a really good balance because I think software is driven very well by business needs, but it's also driven by people's just everyday input as well. So it's kind of a balance. So if we have a customer that needs something that's very important, that roadmap will get skewed a little bit in the direction of that customer, but only in a way that will be beneficial to everyone else. Because most people, when a business chooses to use open source, they have a certain mentality that they understand that the benefit they're getting is they're not having to maintain that software. Because if a business builds their own software, then they need their own development team and they need somebody to do all the stuff we're doing. So basically, even though we have customers who pay us money, they're still kind of in a communal type of mentality because they know by using our software, they can take the parts, they use it in the ways that they need to make their business work, but all the other things that are common, we are working on all the time to keep it up to date and keeping it from bit rotting. So we have a lot of people who really understand that model and prefer to have that, so they only have to manage the part of their infrastructure that interfaces with FreeSWITCH rather than all of FreeSWITCH as well, which has got, when you count all the dependencies, it's pushing 4 million lines of code.
Wow. How much of those 4 million lines of code have come from the community versus, say, what you would consider the core team?
I would say, well, out of the 4 million lines of code, probably about 750,000 of it is brand new code that we've written ourselves in the last 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Roughly, I haven't looked lately. And of that, I would say our team has probably produced at least 80% of it. We get occasionally we'll have someone produced a module or something and kind of donated to us to put in Tree. We have a lot of people submit modifications that are, say, just little fixes, like they'll fix their own bugs sometimes, which is another real great benefit of open source. And you'll have some people that are like, fix my bug, but other people are like, here, I fixed my own bug. And we get to look at those, and we get a lot of those lately. In fact, we took, in the last year, which this is our 10th year of the project now, but starting, we spent a really long time just maintaining everything. What we used to do is we built all of our dependencies ourselves. We had them checked into our project, and we had basically our latest version at all times we kept working. But it became so overwhelming as we started to grow. And we were just having people kind of email us patches or put them in our bug tracker. But because we're an open source project, Atlassian offers us a license to all of their different software. So we started using more of it. We were already using Jira for quite some time now, but we started using Stash, which is another project. It's kind of a Git front end for... it's kind of basically like have your own Google code or something like that, where we host it in our own infrastructure, but it works the same as GitHub and those kinds of things. Pretty much identical to GitHub, I would say. But it's like tied in kind of to our other pieces, like to our bug tracker, to our wiki, to our different stuff. So once we implemented that, now people can open bugs. And when the guy fixes his own bug, he can make a pull request just like he could on GitHub. And now when we want to look at stuff, we can just look in a menu and see them in a row. And it's much easier to manage, and we can, you know, deny it, put comments in, tell people to try again, or just press a button to merge it if everything looks good. And that's great. So that speeds up our ability to kind of process those things. And we've kind of really needed that because we've had a really uptake in the amount of people who are doing stuff. So we have a pretty healthy amount of inbound issue reports on a daily basis. So, and that's made it easier to manage.
Now, if I wanted to help contribute to this project, I'd probably have to have my own itch that I'm trying to scratch, and it's not being scratched properly. Would that be a fair statement?
That's how it works with most people. That's how I started on this kind of thing. You know, I was trying to make something. It didn't work. I had to go there. The next thing I know, I'm learning how to work GDB myself. And, you know, you get sucked in pretty easily. Like, almost all software was started by someone just trying to use some other software. It didn't work quite the way they wanted, and they end up writing a whole new one instead. Like, we've often joked about how we might have this holy grail of bug trackers that we might make that's even better integrated with our needs. And then we were like, stop ourselves, like that commercial where they imagine jetpacks, you know?
Yeah.
Like, if we do that, we'll end up being a new project making a bug tracker. Forget about FreeSWITCH. So, no, we're just going to stick with the one we have.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. And so, where was that here? So, what language is this in?
The predominant amount of code is written in C. We have also embedded languages. So like Perl, for instance, you can embed, and which is kind of fun. I know you like Perl. That might get your eye.
I know a thing or two about Perl, yeah. So yes, that would be great that I could do this. And I also understand Lua as another plugin.
Yep, Lua can be embedded, and also we also have a library called EventSocket library that connects from an external application. So say you can either embed Perl or Lua inside of a script that can run, you know, in the context of your call. You can call and call the Lua script essentially, and it'll run, and then it gives you easier access to do a bunch of mundane stuff, like record a file, play a file back, ask you to type digits. So then people can, with less required skills, develop, you know, basic IVR applications and stuff like that. But at the same time, you can write a standalone program that runs, say, in a different server and uses a network connection to perform a lot of the same stuff, but including event polling and stuff like that. So we have Swig wrappers around that as well. So you could write in Perl a program that runs like on a box that connects over the EventSocket library and then uses that to pull events and send commands to control the call a bunch of the same ways, which is a popular model for some people that want to integrate their existing technology. Say they have an entire infrastructure, they want to throw FreeSWITCH in there too, and they can make a program that's middleware that will interface with it and collect events. We basically chat up everything that happens. Like, if you make a call, there's probably about 30 events that happen throughout the lifetime of that call that you can monitor, and we have environment variables on the call that you can set so that you can put your own business logic into it. A lot of the functionality we've designed is kind of inspired from Apache. I used to be like a web developer in the old days and did a lot of stuff with that. I was heavily influenced by it. That's why we have the modular core and the, being a web 1.0 kind of developer, I have that mentality in my mind. So I really love Unix, and I really love Apache, and I love web programming. So FreeSWITCH is kind of like, if you were a CGI developer from the old days, like, FreeSWITCH will feel familiar to you.
Yeah. Hey, and you mentioned IVR a minute ago. Do you have your own equivalent of Allison Smith, or are you using her voices?
We do. We have GM Voices has an actor. Her name is Callie. That's her name of her character. I forgot what her real name is. I think Kepstril has a artificial voice of her, and we take orders on her. We support multiple sound sets, so we have we keep them all in an XML file, so that we can generate them. Say someone with a setup like you with a nice microphone, we could put you in a studio and you just say every one of the possible things you can say and build a set really quickly. Mm-hmm. So some people make their own. We have other people contribute the sound set in other languages. We've pretty much got maybe like 5 or 6 languages at least. And then we have kind of text-to-speech interfaces as well as, typical glue the words together type of kind of false text-to-speech, which some people like better when it's just like, for small things that they have to change, like saying what the date is or how much money you owe or something. So it's mostly audio files, and it kind of clips them together. So we have a combo of that, so you can use them together if you want. And we have, I think that's pretty much what we have as far as that stuff goes. Standard, we call it the say interface. Basically, you can put together like, it knows the context that you're trying to do. So if you're like trying to say money, it'll know. So it'll say it in the right way that sounds like it's saying money instead of saying $1, $2, $3, $4. It knows to say the more appropriate way.
This is slightly off topic, but I'm always wondering why they still have that stuttery sort of speech for that, where they will go, "Today is Thursday, June 12th. And why do they put gaps between the words like that? That doesn't make any sense.
I think that's just because that's easy, and some people don't want to try much harder than the minimum amount of effort. And like, pretty much, it's more complicated. Is probably the only reason, because you'd have to record the words with every possible intonation if you're using the glue the words together technique. Because when you're just saying four, like if it's in the middle or the end of a sentence, it'll change the inflection and stuff, and nobody wants to do that. And it's so complex that you might as well use text-to-speech at that point, which is better at that. Text-to-speech actually has all those algorithms in it, so it will generate the kind of the up and down ticks the right way.
Cool. And we're almost out of time. Is there anything that we didn't ask that you want to make sure our audience is aware of before we start wrapping up here?
Yes. We wanted to make sure you ask us about KluCon because it's coming up really soon.
I think we did ask about KluCon earlier, but if there's something you think we left out, keep going.
Well, KluCon is a conference which is as old as FreeSWITCH. It's actually 1 year older. The very first KluCon, we were inspired to make the FreeSWITCH project. It was our intention to bring together voice over IP. At the time, this was 2005. This is like way back when you were first starting this thing too, I think even sooner. Voice over IP was still kind of spread apart. There's a lot of people in Europe doing it. No one really understood it. it wasn't really that popular. No one had enough internet bandwidth to do any of the stuff themselves anyway. But we were already into it at that point because we had business needs, and that provided us with networks and stuff that could sustain it. So we were kind of had early adopters of the whole thing. Pretty much now everybody can do it at their house if they want to because of broadband. But back then there's kind of a spread out community, and we wanted to bring everyone together so we could try and collaborate better. So we had our first conference in 2005, and we brought people from all over the world and all the popular projects at the time. And while discussing things there, I mean, we had everybody, people from Asterix and OpenHT23 Project and you name it. We had lots of collaboration. I stayed up really late every day talking and planning stuff and discussing ideas to the point that we got inspired to make FreeSWITCH. And we, you know, from there, at the second KubeCon, we already had a prototype that was working. We gave a really long presentation explaining all the guts of FreeSWITCH and how it works. Mm-hmm. And as years went by, it kind of became like our Super Bowl. That's what I like to refer to it as. It's our entire season revolves around it. Basically, we go to KubeCon, we do the same thing. We talk about stuff. We get inspired for features to add. I kind of mentioned that before. Mm-hmm. Then we spend all year working. I mean, this time of year, we kind of get it all in the right place. We try to get a release done that implements all the stuff we decided. Then we go to KubeCon in August. And then everybody we show off what we have that's new. And everybody that uses all different voice over IP software gives presentations on what they're doing with it. We get some really great and interesting things. And it allows us... The people inspire each other as well as them inspiring us. You make great connections. And it's really hard to describe unless you actually went, because we kind of stumbled into doing it correctly because we just decided it was really important to have a conference, but we're not good at making conferences. We're good at making software. But mm-hmm. I think there's the side effect of that was we invented the kind of a new format for our conference that really works well, and we get lots and lots of feedback about how it's not like any other conference and a lot more fun to go to and kind of informative. We had people say it was this, you know, the same as taking a college course in 2 days flat and all kinds of cool stuff like that. And that's coming up in 1 month from now, and anyone who's watching should come and visit KubeCon.com to see more details, because it's great cool. to have new faces there every year.
Cool, cool. And Mike, same question for you. Is there anything we left out that you want to make sure we spoke about?
I mean, I think we've covered most of it. Just we're really excited about the new video features coming in 1.6, and love for people to check them out and tell us what they think.
Cool. And Mike, a couple questions for you before I let you go. What's your favorite scripting language?
Favorite scripting language? Probably Perl.
Yay, Perl. Finally got a Perl answer here. And what's your favorite text editor? This is going to be a loser.
Favorite text editor. In the terminal, I'm Emacs, and on the Mac, I'm TextMate.
Ah, you're old school. That's great. Emacs. That's two for me. That's good points here. Thank you for answering that way. And other guy whose name scrolled off the screen. Anthony, same questions for you.
Perl and Emacs all the way every day ever since I first saw it back in like
wow.
the 90s.
Wow. Happy dance. All right, Perl and Emacs. You finally.
We need more VIP.
Try Perl for my dying hands. I have a camel book right behind me.
Awesome.
I'll never stop using Perl.
Which edition? Third? Probably?
Probably second or third. Yeah, back from the middle, early 90s.
Cool. Then it has my name on the cover still. Nice. Awesome. Oh, that's great. You just made me very happy. All right. Well, this is worth getting up early for now. All right. Well, hey, guys, it's been really great having you on. I'm going to look into FreeSWITCH some more after I get done with this show, and maybe even someday stop by KubeCon. And thank you for coming on and talking about FreeSWITCH.
Thank you for having us.
Thanks for having us.
Awesome. That was Anthony Minessale and Mike Jerris talking to us about FreeSWITCH. What do you think, Guillermo?
Well, it seems very interesting now. I haven't been in this PBX, software PBX world for a little while. I'm kind of interested in maybe trying to use this for like future videos I do.
Yeah, and I'm thinking of just, running an instance of it. If they said it runs on OS 10, so I'm going to run an instance of it here and maybe use it for some of my video and audio needs. So let's see if that can be plugged into something. This sounds really, really fun, especially 10 years. Man, it's been running for a long time. Very, very cool. Okay, but speaking of that, we got some upcoming guests to talk about real quickly. We're almost out of time, so I want to make sure I don't take too much time with us chatting back and forth. Next week, I will be in Porto Alegre, Brazil, FISLE. Aaron Newcomb's going to be taking over the show. He'll be talking to Rachel Romalitis, and maybe he'll find out how her name is actually pronounced. We're going to do an OSCON pre-show. So she's one of the directors of OSCON, and she's going to talk to us about what's going to be at OSCON 2 weeks later. Then we got Digicam, an advanced digital photo management system. Think of like iPhoto and other applications to try to manage all your things. I apologize if you can hear some sirens here. This happens a lot in Tijuana. You can probably tell. We should have switched to you because you probably don't have sirens near where you are right now.
No, but I do have a little whiny dog next door also, so there you go.
So we get it on the dog show as well. Anyway, let me continue here. Then we're actually at OSCON. We're going to have some surprise guests there, and when we say surprise, because we don't know who it is until we figure out what press releases are happening at OSCON. We're going to have Talkie following that, the video chat and screen sharing system, also using WebRTC, so we could have actually overlapped a little bit with what this show is doing. Gambas, which is the free object-oriented BASIC inspired by Visual BASIC, but not a direct fork of it, just simply inspired by. iChingo, which is a fork. It's a fork of Nagio, scalable and extensible monitoring system. We have Dart coming up about 4 weeks after that. We're still filling in some of the gaps there. And we're going to have Dart back on. We had them on 2 years ago with Seth Ladd, but now it's really advanced. It's really done a lot of stuff and a lot of news to report. Casper Lund, who's one of the actual developers of Dart, the main leader, and Anders Sandholm was responsible for the Dart community or something, sort of like project manager or something. Anyway, sort of like that. On a very short list, just contact last couple days, Kubernetes, which is the project to manage Docker runways, collections of Docker's images. They were inspired by the fact that we had Weave on a while back, but Kubernetes is actually coming out with their own release. They do something very similar, I understand. So we've got them on the very short list. They'll probably have a date coming up soon. You can see all that list and more at twit.tv/floss, which is the homepage for this show. Linked from there will be the big spreadsheet that I use to manage the show. Again, if you have people you want the show, this is how it works. You get them to email me, merlin@stoneage.com. That address is at twit.tv/floss, in case you forget it. We have a live stream. We took a number of questions from there. It's at 8 a.m. Pacific time on Wednesdays on live to twit.tv. And you could ask in the chat room there. You can watch the video and behind the scenes how we produce pieces of the show there. Often a lot of fun, a lot of entertaining things occasionally happen here. You can follow us on Floss Weekly at Google Plus and at Floss Weekly on Twitter. You can follow me on Twitter at merlyn, but I'm more often just speaking on Google Plus directly. You interact with me better there. That's at Randall L. Schwartz. I will be at FISLE next week. I actually have two talks now. They had a dropout. So one of the talks, of course, will be about Dart, which I'm busily writing. I've got to get it finished by next week. And but they also wanted another talk, so I'm going to redo the show I did at OSCON 2 years ago on my half-life with Perl, or is it half my life with Perl? Anyway, I'm 50, Perl's 25. I want to talk about the intertwining of both of those. Really great stuff. You can actually see it on Vimeo somewhere. I think if you Google for Half-Life with Perl on Vimeo, you'll see a taping we did of it down at one of the conferences here. I'll be at OSCON in July, which is just a mere 2 weeks, no, 3 weeks from now. And I'm also going to be a guest on another podcast about decentralization, about things like Bitcoin, but libertarianism and a bunch of things all sort of in that area. It'll be decentralized.fm. I'll be recording about 3 weeks from now, I think. And I'll let you know exactly when that show airs so that I can have you listen to be there. Enough plugs for me. Guillermo, anything you want to plug today?
Well, I'll be at the Embedded Systems Conference here in Silicon Valley soon. I think it's by the end of this month. And I am relaunching my YouTube channel that I keep saying that I keep doing, but now it's up there. So you can either Google Guillermo Amaral in YouTube or just look for me on Twitter, and I have a link on the a little profile there. That's at GAMARAL. That's pretty much it.
Cool, cool. And thank you, Guillermo, for showing up for this South of the Border show. I may end up doing more of these. We'll see, as long as the data still keeps working here. And thanks for being my co-host.
No problem, man. Anytime.
And now we're going to have to go out for tequila later somewhere, right?
Yeah, of course.
All right. And we'll see you all again next week on Floss Weekly.